Okay, so Team Star. These guys, I feel, are very similar to Team Skull. The only difference, really, is that whereas Team Skull was kind of a front operation to block out the Aether Foundation, these guys are literally just a bunch of punks that have dropped out and are kind of messing around. They don't have anybody they're covering up, so they basically just exist as a bunch of delinquents messing around, and I'm alright with that in terms of what the story is trying to do. You don't need an evil organization, but it would have been nice to have the option to join Team Star instead of just have the option to destroy it. Like, it's an open world game, everybody's gonna have their own different opinions. I mean, come on, guys. Give us more choices in these games. We'll be right back. So I just want to make something very clear right now. This is on authentic hardware, and this is not edited in any way. This is how this game runs. Look at how the NPCs are just kind of jittering back and forth in fragmented fashion. This is horrendously terrible. Like, I can't believe it looks like this. This from a multi-billion dollar company, no less. Like, come on, guys, this is pathetic. Thank you. If I'm being completely honest, this little exchange initially made me think that the director was almost certainly Cassiopeia, but, like...
Thank you.
So I kind of wanted to take a moment to point out that Area Zero and the history of Paldea actually has some interesting lore implications and connections, but I'll save all of that for later on when it becomes more relevant. For now, like, it's just a mysterious area that we don't know anything about, so I won't go into too much detail about it at this moment. And yet another mechanic for the open world that would have been really interesting to add into the game. So, Gen 2 had a customizable playroom, Gen 3 had secret bases, Gen 4 had secret bases. There was always a lot of opportunity to customize and design your stuff. I looked all over in Scarlet and Violet, I could not find a way to customize your room. This is actually really stupid and sad. Like, if there is a way, then I'll take this back, but I don't think you can customize your room, which is really freaking stupid for an open world game if you can't, because, like, you even unlock the ability to go into your rival's dorms later and take a look at them, and, like, you could see how different their personalities are reflecting their dorms. They don't give you the option to do that with yours!
Why? 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 We'll be right back.
And now it's time to address the big claim that this game made. So, Pokemon Scarlet and Violet were advertised as open world games, and according to the main page and the trailers that were released about this game, the big selling point is that you can do the, like, gyms or the challenges in any order that you want. So, for example, you could go straight to the ice gym right off the start if you wanted. That's not at all how this game works. There is a set linear pathway just like every other Pokemon game, and choosing to deviate from it will basically penalize you for attempting to experiment a bit. Every single area has a set level, so there's an intended order which I'll post on screen that you're supposed to do the gyms and everything in. And while you would think that you can still deviate from it, you just have to grind, this game enforces the level cap of previous games more than the other games. Now, what I mean by that is, in all the previous games, in order to maintain control of your Pokemon, you needed to earn badges to get their respect. In most games, any Pokemon you caught would obey you no matter what. In Scarlet and Violet, that still applies to your starter Pokemon and any Pokemon you catch below the cap while it's active. So, for example, the cap at the start of the game is level 20. Any Pokemon you catch before level 20 will obey you even if they go over that cap. But the second you catch a Pokemon at level 20 or 21, they'll stop obeying you. They will not do shit for you. Like all games, when Pokemon don't obey, they randomly fall asleep, they randomly use wrong moves, and they sometimes just won't do anything. So, yeah, that's not fun. If you go to challenge some of the stronger gyms, like for example the Ice Gym or the Ghost Gym early on, unless you literally power grind your starter and only your starter and maybe a few of the Pokemon you catch on the early routes, you're not going there early on because the Ice Gym is way out of your payroll and you don't stand a chance. You will just get completely curb stomped by level 45-ish Pokemon. Now, this wouldn't sound so bad. I mean, the other Pokemon games were like this too, so why is it a problem here? Well, the problem is that Pokemon Scarlet and Violet are trying to claim to be an open world game. And as an open world game that encourages you to try different things, there should be scaling applied so that you can do the gyms in any order. Scaling would have basically used the exact same system that currently exists in the game as it is, except instead of the bug gym always being the weakest, the first gym you go to would have been the weakest, and they would have gradually gotten harder as you went along. So for example, if you wanted to do a challenge run, you could still do them in the linear order, but if you wanted to actually try any order that you wanted, you could have gone to the psychic gym first, and they would have been at a low level so you could manage it. It just seems like the most logical answer. What we're left with is just a game that feels like it can't decide if it wants to be a linear standard RPG like the other games, or break the habit and try something new. So it ends up being this weird half and half that doesn't commit to the change, which, it's not a good look, I'll say that much. There are some good points about this system, but if you wanted to just experience a game where you could go anywhere, build a team, and then challenge the gym as you go, you're not going to be able to do that. You'll be able to do it as you progress in the linear way, but that's it. The point I'm really trying to get at here is if you want to build a team before you start the gym challenge or majorly go out, like you just want to go and gather your team first, most of them are not going to obey you, so the point of trying to catch them now is moot. You might as well just wait until you've got enough badges to control them before you even try to catch them, which is just the same experience of every other Pokemon game we've played, so what's the point of having a wide open world if it's the same? So Terror Raid battles. I was stupid in my playthrough and didn't start doing these until later on. Unlike Sword and Shield raids, which could be very frustrating for an early player, Terror Raids are regularly not that bad as long as you have a super effective move. Do them early and do them repeatedly because they make some aspects of this game much less painful. Thank you. So you may be asking yourself, why have I gone into the options menu here? Well, in pretty much every Pokemon game, there's an option between set and switch mode, which enables you to decide whether or not you can instantly switch Pokemon after KOing people. Most people recommend setting it to set mode because that more reflects the online and multiplayer function of the game where you can't switch Pokemon after KOing somebody. Scarlet and Violet outright removed this mechanic, so now you have to have switch mode active. This feels very similar to the all XP share that you can't shut off. Many people have complained about how stupid this is, so now if you want to imitate set mode, you basically just have to not switch out when given the option at all. Nobody's gonna do that, but hey, let's just remove other features that allow you to have your own adventure. Again, to show that I'm not completely bitter and just angry about everything in this game, riding Maridon and Coridon feels really fantastic. They control really well, the movement is fluent, like, it's actually really well done. I like this mechanic a lot more. It's way more fun than the bike or any of the other, like, abilities that you had in previous games. And the removal of HMs was also relatively nice. You don't need those Pokemon that exist specifically to carry around and do the job of getting rid of rocks for you anymore. There's no roadblocks like that in these games, which honestly is kinda nice. I like that. You can just use whatever team you want. In fact, this is, I think, the first generation of Pokemon where after a while I didn't use a water type because I didn't need Surf. Like, that's actually kind of refreshing. And now I'm kind of experimenting with the auto battle mechanic. So, this feature was also advertised and is an interesting decision. You can send out your Pokemon for auto battling and they'll battle anything they come into contact with, without you having to do anything. As long as the Pokemon is strong enough to beat them either by higher level or superior type, they usually will win. If they don't, they run back to you at half health and won't battle anymore. You can do this for so long before the Pokemon will get tired and require a rest, in which case you have to go to the Pokemon Center, but it's an interesting mechanic. Problem is, this mechanic has a lot of bugs associated with it. For starters, if your Pokemon reaches a level where they should evolve when you're using this mechanic, they just won't. And for some reason, you can't do the Legends Arceus method of evolving in the menu anymore. So if you hit an evolving level and don't evolve because you were using the auto battle, you have to get another level to replace that. In addition to this, they won't learn moves, but that can be mitigated in the menu, so that's not as big a deal. One mechanic that is nice about this is if you auto battle a shiny Pokemon, it won't be knocked out. The Pokemon will actually choose not to fight the shiny, so hey, if you're shiny hunting and you want auto battle, you don't gotta worry about KOing the shiny, so that's nice. Okay. I haven't really gotten a chance to mention it yet, but the battle themes in this game might be some of my all-time favorites in the series. Like, it's so funky sounding, and there's so much variety in the different styles utilized and stuff. Like, it's a really solid soundtrack. I actually recommend listening to the soundtrack of this game. It's just, in general, some great music. So, Gimmighoul. This Pokemon is a very unique Pokemon. First of all, it's a ghost type, but the method to evolve it is very interesting and actually plays well into the open world. So, to evolve Gimmighoul, you need to gather 999 Gimmighoul coins. Now, to get those coins, you have to find Gimmighouls, which will start appearing all over the map once you've caught at least one of them. They kind of remind me a lot of Korok seeds from Breath of the Wild, and they're literally everywhere. You'll start to find them constantly as you go through your journey. They're not going to be in big chests like this, that's only the catchable Gimmighouls, but you'll hear like their cry and you'll see them holding a coin out in the middle of nowhere. Sometimes they're in public places too, like near Pokemon centers. It's kind of a neat idea. I like it. I kind of wish there were more Pokemon that evolved this way, but I also kind of wish that it wasn't 999 coins. I kind of wanted to use one until I realized that it's going to take forever to get that many. By the time I finish the game, I think I've only got around 287 of them. So, yeah, that wasn't happening.